Good morning, everyone. This is Naveen Kumar from University of Maryland Eastern Shore. I'm an assistant professor of horticulture. And here I am again this year. And I will present this data into three sections. In first section, I will talk about how we will try to make low tunnels using inexpensive material for our small farmers, especially on our Eastern Shore. Secondly, yield data about day neutral cultivars. If we plant very, very late, I planted in July. And third thing is I will give you an update regarding my nano horticulture work, just like last year. So what we achieved. So always I start with the history of our area. So this is a newspaper clipping from 1920. The Chicago Packer, which indicates industry, strawberry industry on the Eastern Shore was vast. 720 railroad cars during the strawberry season shipped out from the Eastern Shore of Maryland, especially Marion Station. So this is the picture of Marion Station. It's in the Crisfield area. And this area was regarded as a strawberry capital of the world. Now it's regarded as a ghost town in the United States of America. So this is our advancement for last 100 years. So data about three states, 1925, look here, 7,000 acres in Maryland, Delaware more than 2,500, Virginia more than almost 6,000. What happened by 2012? More than 95% decline in our industry, right? And look at this picture. It's okay. No, it's not okay. It's the time to think to restart our industry. And this is one of my vision, and I am working on the Eastern Shore. So why day neutrals and protective structures? So first thing is season extension. If we grow June bearers, of course, spring at the most summer, and then we are done. But with the day neutrals, and I learned a lot from Dr. Levers. And if you are using low tunnels, we can extend the season up to December. Quality and quantity, there are reports which showed that if you will grow day neutral strawberries under protective coverings, they may have higher content of antioxidant. This is wonderful. We can also protect from various fungal and bacterial diseases if our strawberries are covered. And look here, local inclement weather. I am in Maryland for the last 3 years, and what I am observing, it's rain. Okay, it's not Florida. I came from Florida, and I go, okay, so now I made Maryland into Florida. Something wrong. So excessive rainfall, and rain brings enormous amount of diseases, right? Different diseases, and especially on the Eastern Shore, my goodness, you will find each and every one. So not only this, drought and heat stress in major strawberry producing area. So they are struggling with drought and stress and water supply. So it's the right time to start our local industry. And in fact, in some countries, there is a rain god. For example, in India, we have a rain god. We pray God, if there is a drought, okay, rain, please, every day. But here, I think we have to create a rain god and to say, stop, or please stop. I think that will work. So last year, I got a grant. This is called Delmarva grant. And I am working in association with Virginia State University. So our main target is to evaluate different type of day neutral cultivars to study growth and development. Then find out what are our indigenous diseases and can we solve them using nanotechnology. And extension outreach, that's what I'm doing now. So look here, it's a very late planting. We started preparing field on 26th of June. All the recommended practices were used. So height of the bed, 7 inches, width 3 feet, length of the bed is almost 100 feet, 1.25 mil mulch we use. We use a drip tape that delivers 0.28 gallons per hour. And plant geometry is plant to plant distance 1 feet, row to row 1 feet, bed to bed 5 feet, and we planted July 5th, very late. For example, if love someone strawberry so much, okay, I want to grow strawberry, whatever it is. So even under those conditions, in fact, what happened with me, my field was not ready. It's always rain. I was not able to make the bed. So finally, I got the time. Okay, this is the June. Let's make the bed and let's see what we can achieve if I love a strawberry. I want my customers to come to my field and I want to sell a strawberry. So this is how I designed this experiment. Okay. So construction of low tunnels, pretty interesting. So we purchased 1-inch pipe, correct? And divided into 2 feet each. So this 1-inch pipe we inserted on the each side of the bed. So these are 2 feet, so 1 foot is inserted in the ground on both the sides, look here like this. 1 inch, almost 1 foot is inside. And then we purchased 1/2-inch plastic PVC pipes. These are 10 feet. And then we fixed on both the sides. So here we have a hoop number one. So these tunnels are 100 feet. So using 18, we can make 90 feet tall, long tunnels. So these hoops are at every 5 feet. Okay. So every 5 feet, then what we did, we sealed them using a duct tape so that in case of rain, they may come out or high wind velocity. Not only this, we also put side PVC pipes, around 1/2-inch, 10 feet long. So provide a strengthy structure to these tunnels. So these tunnels are actually look like this. So we have a side, thank you. This is almost 2 feet away. And we are still working on to design the height or standardize the height of these side pipes. We also use T-post at the end of each end of the tunnel. Then we use a central twine that run throughout these, all the hoops. They further tighten the entire tunnel. And then we use a 100 feet by 12 feet clear plastic polythene film. It's 92% transparency. And we use just simply the rope or twine. And we tied the twine at the end of these side pipes so that we can hold the plastic. And it works very well. For last 6 months, nothing happened. We are happy and the tunnel is also happy. So we enjoy, we dance. Once all the tunnels completed, and what we observed, two guys can make the entire tunnel within 2 hours from the beginning. So 90 feet tunnel, 2 hours, two guys, that's it, and we can complete it. So the cost we calculated based upon the thing, if this entire structure have a life of 4 years, in that case, each tunnel will be around $57. Because if you will look at the warranty, this plastic can survive for 4 years. Plastic, they can survive for so many years. So I simply divided it by 4, the total cost. So it's not expensive at all. And this tunnel is 90 feet. That means you can grow, I think, 180 plants under these tunnels. Okay, what happened? So after planting in July, just after 15 days, my research was in the tummy of these deers. They started enjoying my plants. So someone told me, okay, install electric fence. I go, okay, I will install it. Then someone, half of the people, they told me, oh, it will not work. They can jump. But there was one wise guy who told me, Naveen, apply peanut butter on the wire. Okay, let's see. And I apply the peanut butter on the various corners of these wires. And you will not believe, 6 months, not a single attack of any deer in my field. And I have no hard feeling. If you love deer, I also love deer. But it just gave only a shot. They never came to my field. However, they enjoyed the soybean growing side, but nothing happened. So fertilizer. Recommended practice, 60 pounds of calcium ammonium nitrate during the preparation of beds. After that, 5 pounds of nitrogen using CAN and ammonium nitrate every week. And we alternate it because potassium and calcium both are important for the growth and development of strawberries. Moisture, we install some tensiometers in each and every tunnels. And if the reading shows minus 30 centibars, we started irrigation. I used this small instrument and this worked very well for a small area as a fertilizer injector. We directly connected to the water supply and there you go. And we use a dye also. So this is how we look during the protection if temperature is low, we can cover it. So that's the problem where we have to untie all the knots each time if the temperature is going down. So that is the drawback. So what we are thinking, these pipes will be somewhere here this season, so that there will be no need to untie the knots each time. This is how look. We open if the temperature is high, open the tunnel, no problem. You can solve that problem also. And it's not only this. See, look at the distance. One can easily pick the strawberries because people generally think, okay, these are covered, you have to bend, you will be in trouble for the pick. No, one can easily pick the strawberries under low tunnels. So what was our design? The design is we have four tunnels, 90 by 3 feet, alternatively open bed conditions, because we want to compare open bed with the tunnels. So four varieties, Red Start from Michigan State University, Albion, Marady, Des Bois, Portola. I use these four. This year I will use 11 different kinds of day neutrals to test. Look here, we have almost 160 replicates. So it's not like we are using five or six. This is a very robust experiment and required a lot of hard work. So I have an army of six students. So we were busy throughout the season designing the RCBD. So we took a large number of observation. For example, all the vegetative structure, number of crowns, leaf area, fresh weight, dry weight, everything to find out what factor actually regulating the yield under late planting. But I will not discuss all of them. I will only discuss yield parameters. So after 60 days, this is how they look like. These are under tunnels. These are under open bed conditions. They look good. Data will show the real picture. So very complicated graph, let me make it pretty simple. So on y-axis, this is the yield gram per plant. On the x-axis, we have varieties. Varieties under open bed, varieties under low tunnel. So these are the pairs like thing, V2, V3, V4, right? Different color shows different months of the year. So if we look at the yield, there is no yield in V1. So we will discuss, they didn't produce any fruit almost for the 6 months. V2 Albion, it produced little bit, but non-marketable. Same thing is with V3. So the first three varieties, they didn't produce anything. Everything is non-marketable. So at least we got something. Okay, if we want to grow strawberries, at least don't pay attention to these three. Because yield was non-marketable. And look here, Portola, wonderful varieties. It grew very well. This is the only variety with marketable yield. And if we will see the effect of open bed and low tunnels, look here, this is open bed and this is low tunnel. So yield is 34.6% more under low tunnel conditions. So that means low tunnel is working, giving us money back. But the important thing here is, look here, this yield was mostly restricted to 2 months, September and October. After that, yield declined. So under low tunnels, almost 465 gram per plant, under open bed 305 gram per plant. So an increase in 34.6%. So let's talk about the number of flowers. So why there was no yield in variety V1 and V2? Because the number of flowers were less, and the flowers was only for a 1 month. Look here, only for August and at the most September. So that's why V1 and V2, there is no fruit, because variety did not produce any flowers in rest of the season. So flower only for 1.5 months, September and 15 days of October, and then done. However, V3 produced large number of flowers, but the problem is size of the fruit remain very small. They cannot pass US grade 1 or US grade 2 or their combination. It's useless, nothing. However, V4, wonderful, large number of flower. And look here, the effect of tunnel. Open bed and low tunnel, 31% more flower. So why more yield in Portola? Because there are more flowers, right? Okay. So number of fruits, exactly, they complement the data of flowers. There is no fruit here, very little. And look here, number of fruits, 36.7% more fruit under low tunnel condition. That means low tunnel is wonderful and it's working. Disease, this is the most dominant disease I observed, last year, leaf spot, and look here how it develops. It started from July end with a small spot, look like this, and then keep on number increasing, then they fuses with each other and finally make small holes. And finally in December, this is Portola. So the thing is, Portola is wonderful, right? It giving us yield even after planting in July. But the problem is, this variety is most susceptible for leaf spot, and this is how it ends. Entire removal of the plant. Okay. So let's see how low tunnels protect it. Let's talk about the Portola. Under open bed condition, look here. Almost 100% plants are infected. Under open bed, continuous rain, fluctuating weather, under low tunnel, look here. 60% less, only 40% plants were infected. That is one of the reason why, in part, one of the reason why Portola is producing more yield at the point of view of protection from leaf spot. I did not spray any fungicide because this is how I do research. In the first year, understand what are our indigenous problem and what worst can happen with your crop. So this is the worst, there is no plant. Okay. So we conducted one workshop. Workshop are generally rare on the Eastern Shore. So we conducted a strawberry workshop, 20 growers came. Then we have a visitors from Virginia State University, 32 farmers came and look at our tunnels. What is the most important thing here? Three small farmers this year, they ordered day neutral strawberries. That's my achievement, I think. From zero to three, and that is wonderful. One growers told me, okay, Naveen, I am going to build low tunnel this year. So this is the impact of this work. We just started last year. So in conclusion, low tunnel can be beneficial if we can plant early. You're getting my, so the thing is, yield will start from May to December. Look at the time interval, correct? But if we are late like me, July, you have only 2 months, September and October. So that's why I only got 1 pound per plant. Instead of people, they can 1.8 kilogram per plant, 1.6 kilogram per plant. So you have a large window, almost 9 months. But if you are planting late, you have only 2 months. And I already showed the first three varieties, they didn't perform well. Portola performed wonderful, but highly susceptible to leaf spot. That means we have to use different kinds of fungicide to solve this problem. Maybe next year I will show you if my nanoparticles can solve this problem. So this is an update. So last year I showed my data. I used nano zinc oxide to control several diseases. But when I presented my data in American Society for Horticulture Science last year in Washington, D.C., they asked me, Naveen, you used only nanoparticles, right? You used nano zinc oxide. Why you did not use common zinc oxide, which is normally present? That was the right point because I have only control and nano. So where is the micro? Because generally, zinc oxide is micrometer in diameter. They asked me, okay, there is a possibility this micrometer zinc oxide can also work. Why you didn't try this? And because of this, I am not able to publish my two papers. And that's how we learned by discussing our data with everyone. So this year I repeated the experiment and I use this nano zinc oxide, common, not nano. So look here. What happened? This is the third instar stage of soybean looper. This is after 24 hours, nothing happened, they survived. They enjoyed actually zinc oxide, I think. Same thing is here, second instar, look at the size, nothing happened. First instar, that means all the three stages, nothing happened with micro or common zinc oxide present. Okay, so I proved them, okay, nano is working, micro is not working. Next is, then I repeated, last year I used only one cutoff of size, 10 to 30 nanometer. So this is 10 to 30 nanometer. Everything is dead within 5 to 24 hours. Look at the size of this guy. They are done within 5 hours by desiccation or cleavage, everything, they are gone. This is 10 to 30 nanometer, all the stages, L1, L2, and L3, everything is dead. Then I used 40 to 60 nanometer. Everything gone again, nothing survived. I use 100 to 80 to 100 nanometer. This is black in color. This size nano zinc oxide. So, but nothing survived. Everything is gone within 5 to 24 hours. 200 nanometer. This is important. 200 nanometer is pretty big size. The thing is, in certain countries, anything below 100 nanometer, they will not consider it organic. That means we can use nanoparticles in organic cultivation because this size is pretty large, 200 nanometer. And this is also effective killing the loopers. So that's why I studied this. Can we increase the size? So by 200 nanometer, it is effective. So far, I think there is no law through National Organic Promotion Board. There is no such guidelines, what type of nanoparticles, they even consider it or not. I don't think so. But in other countries, this is the cutoff. Anything below 100 nanometer, you cannot use it. It's not organic. This is the latest. I got fire blight in my apple orchard. Wonderful. So I isolated two strains. Yet to be confirmed, these are fire blight bacteria or not. But I got two types of colonies from the vascular system. One is giving yellow color and another is white colonies. So I worked on yellow. And look here. These are the plates made up of nanoparticles and this is control. So after 4 days, look at the colonies. They started growing. Nothing in nanoparticles. This is wonderful. Though I have to confirm this is Ervinia amylovera or not. But this bacteria didn't grow at all in my plates. And after confirmation, maybe next year, I will show more details. The problem here is nanoparticles are working. But the thing is, how to make a formulation so that they can be effective under field condition? Sometimes even it is difficult to suspend nanoparticles in water. So this year, we solved that problem. We find some organic solvent. And we can easily suspend the particles. Look here, these plates. Last year, we were not even able to make these plates. We got very irrelevant data. Somewhere there is nanoparticles, somewhere there is not. But this year we have very uniform application because of that particular solvent. So we are actually developing this program slowly. Because another thing is there is no toxic studies out. How these nanoparticles will affect human health. So everything is under controlled and covered condition, especially in greenhouse or our lab, or restricted up to petri plates. So once we will get data, there are very few studies about toxicity. They did it on some mice or et cetera, but very few papers. So it will take time, but these are effective. And all these nanoparticles, they are elemental metals present on the earth crust. We are not using anything dangerous, toxic. So maybe nanotechnology will be the future of our horticulture. Thank you very much. Any question? Thank you.